In 2013, the National Institute of Health awarded a $3 million grant to the Purdue Stuttering Project, a group of professors and researchers who are working to develop a speech therapy screening tool to better identify which preschool children are most likely to continue stuttering as they grow older.
I'm fascinated by humans' ability to communicate and the importance of our communication and how much, of course, our self-esteem, our livelihoods, our emotional contact with others depends on how well we communicate. And so I became particularly interested in the area of stuttering because it's been a disorder that people have studied for a long time, but we haven't made good progress.
The National Institutes of Health, there's just very few grants that have been awarded to researchers in the field of stuttering. We are a group of researchers and clinicians and students who all work together to understand how stuttering develops in young children.
The overall goal is, often when children are 4 years old and they're stuttering, a lot of physicians and speech therapists and teachers will tell the parent, just wait and see, they'll probably outgrow it. Well, they might outgrow it, but they might not. So our goal is we're not only trying to identify which children are likely to persist in stuttering, but we're trying to develop a screening tool that speech therapists will be able to use, for example, in the school systems or in other settings, that will help them make a decision, this child needs therapy, this child, you know, is likely, we can just wait and see if they recover.
Something that's interesting about stuttering is that it doesn't occur when a child first begins to talk, when they're just saying one word at a time, for example. It happens when they start putting words together, when language starts to become more complex. Ann Smith and I, who are the principal investigators on this grant, it's funded through the National Institutes of Health. It's a 5-year grant, and we're looking at 3 major domains that have been shown to be important in stuttering. We're looking at a motor domain, so how is speech-motor coordination developing in a young child? We're looking at their language processing, and then finally, emotional aspects. We're looking at those as well.
So far, for the grant we got in 2013, we have 40 children who stutter, and 20 children who are controls. Some of it is behavioral testing in the sense of standardized tests, looking at their speech abilities, their language, their nonverbal abilities, their memory skills, their rhyming. But we also do physiological measures.
We do language sampling. They play, they speak with a parent or a caregiver as well as one of our researchers. So we get a really good sample of what their speech is like. And then for the physiological measures, they come in, for example, in this lab, and they get an electrode cap put on where we can record how their brain is responding to funny sentences that they hear or words that rhyme or don't rhyme. And we can see from their brain waves whether or not they're really distinguishing between different kinds of things that they're listening to.
So my research uses a relatively newer neuroimaging technique called functional near-infrared spectroscopy, or FNIRS. We're actually measuring neurological response during speech production. So the kids are wearing kind of a headpiece, and there's optodes that emit a light that's just a harmless light that passes through the skull and to the outer layers of the brain called the cortex. And we have detecting optodes where we can get a measure of the blood that's flowing, the oxygenated and deoxygenated blood that's flowing in the brain.
This picture is silly because there's a guy watering her in the shower. She's pouring milk on a hamburger.
What's really nice about this particular grant is that when these kids first come in, they're 4 and 5, and they're preschoolers. And we have a group of children who are stuttering at that age, but we're following them for 5 years. And so we're able to look at them each year, and about half of those kids will recover, and about half won't. So that allows us then to go back in time and look at their data from when they were 4 and 5. And so we're able to look at their physiological data, their speech samples, their language samples, and we can say, is there anything in here in the motor domain, language, or emotional domain that may have predicted the course of recovery? And what that's going to help us do is identify those key variables or factors that may be critically important to look at when you're testing a preschooler.
We are still recruiting children for the studies, so if parents have any concerns that their child might be stuttering, we're looking for 4 and 5-year-old children, they can certainly contact us here. And you know, sometimes they don't know if they're stuttering, and that's okay. We will give them feedback, we will write a report, we will make referrals if that's appropriate. So we welcome any phone calls, even if it's just to talk.
Lots of people who stutter actually go on to accomplish great things. It doesn't have to be a hindrance in their life. It's a disorder where the person knows exactly what they want to say. It is not linked to intelligence at all. A person can be extremely smart, have good language skills, and yet have these involuntary disruptions in their speech. And so it's something that I think if we can find ways to either alleviate or prevent persistence in that disorder, I think that would be just a great thing to accomplish.
For more information about the Purdue Stuttering Project, please visit the web address below.